Today's video is lubricated by Juice of the Oats Oatmeal Stout from Oxus Brewing Company right here in Winnipeg. As it say, an easy drinking dark ale with the aroma of coffee and chocolate. Its creamy, smooth body comes from the usage of oats in the mash. And yeah, that doesn't have quite a stouty head on it, but it's pretty good. So today, I'm going to get into this package here that came in from a relatively local supplier, Universal Solder in Yorkton, Saskatchewan, which I could drive there and back in a day. However, it took Canada Post a week to get it here, which is not too bad. But I figured that since I discovered this guy, and since he's got a few kits that he actually makes himself, or created himself, what is that? Oh, that's okay, that's the invoice. I'll just leave that over there out of the way. So, he's got a couple of kits that he seems to have designed himself. So I figured I'd grab one just to play with. And I'll show you on his website actually what it is before I open it up here. Yeah, let's do that. So here's what I bought. 3x smallest Arduino UNO Nano Class 18Mega328P Breadboard Buddy. Version 2 including USB adapter. So yeah, it's 3 of this kit, which is basically a full-size 18Mega328, the Arduino chip, on a breadboard-friendly little board that's very similar to the size of a Nano, actually. And the 3 of them in the kit came together with a little programmer board, which is cool. And that's not a bad price, actually, plus shipping, of course. He also sells on eBay, though, for almost the same price. But yeah, this is one of the kits that seem to be something that he's done himself under this Canaduino brand name, which is kind of cool. Here's the actual boards that I've got. And it is, so it's already pre-programmed and it's got a modified blink in it. It's basically stripped back to the bare minimum. Oh, we've even got assembly instructions. That's cool. I shall be keeping this open beside me while I'm working on it. But there's the schematic, which is basically the minimum viable do-it-yourself Arduino schematic, which is the chip, the crystal and its 2 capacitors, looks like a couple of bypass capacitors. Okay, there's a couple of extra things. This 10K pull-up resistor against the reset button, and a couple of LEDs, one being power and one being, I'm guessing that is D13. Yes, it is. Okay, so it's pretty straightforward. It doesn't even have a voltage regulator on it, so you got to be a little bit careful with the power, but he says anywhere between 3.8 and 5.5 should work just fine. USB or 3 AAA batteries, something like that. Cool. So I'm going to put one of these guys together just for the fun of it, and I'm going to make use of my new helping hands unit here. I just have to rearrange my workbench a little bit to make room for that and my beer. And I think I will use for solder. This is the old Radio Shack solder that I've had forever. And I found at work in a toolbox in the corner a slightly skinnier Kester branded solder, which is good stuff. It's going to be miles better than this cheap shit that I got from China not too long ago. So I will be using that for the solder. Let's get these arms out of the way. Let's pop this packaging open. So this being 3 full kits in one, there's going to be lots of duplication. I guess I'll have to I'm going to grab a parts drawer just to toss it into too. Okay, so there's a parts drawer. There is the programmer, USB to TTL. It's got some flux residue on the back side. That's not a big deal. So what do we have here? So we have a standard CH340 based USB to serial programmer. You can select either 3.3 or 5 volts over there. 12 meg crystal on board, USB on this side. And the standard pins over on this side. 5 or 3, TX, RX, and ground. So what do we got here? Bunch of header pins. Some female headers. 3 pushy buttons for resets. Some 16 meg crystals. We have a bunch of capacitors and resistors and LEDs. Okay, that's kind of a bluish white. Now then, resistors and capacitors. Let's quickly give them a sorting here. Okay, we've got 2 different types of capacitors and 6 of them, so 2 per kit. We got 104s, which are 100 nanofarad, and we've got 18 is the label on them, which are 18 picofarad. Okay, but then we have the circuit boards. Nicely done little circuit boards too. Breadboard Buddy, Arduino, universal solder. Okay. Fairly dense board for through-hole too. Power LED, reset capacitor, L3 resistors that are underneath the chip, and then capacitor, crystal, and the programming header. And of course, the brains of the operation, the 18 Mega 328P and sockets for them. So the parts list calls for the series resistors for the LEDs to be 1.2K. However, the ones that were sent with it look like they're 680s, 680 ohm, which is not a big deal. We're not going to blow up the LEDs. That's still, even at 5 volts, that's still not going to be a problem. When it's a nice safe number, but just an interesting discrepancy. So the build instructions say put the resistors in first. R1, that one there, is the 10K, which is the pull-up on the reset. Get you in there. As usual, I'm not bending these super duper accurately, just making them fit. Give that a little kick out. Park him up there. Then the other 2 resistors are the series resistors for the LEDs, and they're both the same. So they are R2 and R3. He's actually got the pads fairly tight to the size of the components. I guess to make it this compact, that kind of has to happen. So again, we'll just give those guys a little bit of a tweak. Not as bad as some, I know some people were complaining about, who was it? I can't even remember whose video it was, where they were putting just crazy bends on their component leads. I'm not doing that, but okay, some of those are a little bit bent down. So now then, with that up there, that's in a really convenient place for me to see it. What does it do for you? Focus on that, please. Thank you. Okay, let's get some solder in here and get busy. That's nice. So even though I've got the camera just in front of my forehead, and even though it's zoomed in, I'm just looking with my eyes right past it right now to try and get at this, because that way I can use both eyes. Looking through the camera, I sort of lose my binocular vision. So now then, what happens? Are those two pads? No, those two pads aren't the same. So I have to be careful not to short them. I think that looks pretty good for a start. Where's my snippers? So the second step is the crystal and the push button, according to the instructions. The push button's already got its leads folded, so that's easy. And the crystal goes down this end. Crystals don't really care which way they go. Do I want to leave it up off the board a little bit, or do I want to put it right flat? What does the real Uno do? It puts it right flat. Okay, I shall too. Give that just an ever so slight little skew there. Now with the crystal, I want to be really careful not to get it too hot, because you don't want to deform it or cause it any particular grief. Push buttons, not so much. But I mean, still, you can get in and out pretty quickly, so why wouldn't you? Okay, for cutting off the crystal's leads, I'm not going to use my sharp nippers. I'm going to use these old dull ones because, well, this is a little bit controversial, but a training course that I took from Alcatel years ago said, or told us, when we were cutting the leads off a crystal, when we're replacing it in a microwave radio oven, crystal oven, to not use a pair of cutters that snaps, because that could shock the crystal and mechanically damage it. I don't know how much that is abundance of caution and how much it's reality, but it just seems like a painless precaution to take if you've got the ability. So those old dull cutters kind of mash it a little bit rather than going snap when they go through like these nice sharp ones do. So, I don't know. Next is the capacitors. C1 and 4 are the two 10400 nanofarad capacitors. So there is C1. And there is C4. I'll push those guys in and give them a little bit of a tweak again, as usual. I think I might just do it this way this time. Yeah, I can get it that fairly easily. There we go. Do a little push up from the other side after the first pad's on. Just to make sure it's in place. Okay, give those guys a little haircut. And I think next is the dip socket. Right. So having it in that foam, you know, didn't protect it from bending quite as much as you'd hope, but so be it. The notch end goes up where the capacitors are, showing you where pin 1 goes. And so I'll put the notch into the socket at that same end. That kind of holds itself in there. That's nice. I'll just grab onto there. You know, I almost could have done this with a smaller iron, or a smaller tip on my iron. So as usual with a socket or something like that, I'll just do the two diagonal corners and then push from the other side and just make sure it's right seated. So that's got it mechanically held. Now, let's just rotate this a little bit. I'll just blitz along and solder him up. That was me using both cleaning methods on my iron, one right after the other, and it cooled the iron down a little bit. Soldered. I don't see any bridges. Yes, the flux is messy. Okay, what's next?
The two LEDs. The short leads of both LEDs over the flat side show the text L and power. The long leads show to the reset button.
Okay. So the long lead goes towards the reset button. Okay, so there's the two LEDs, but I just noticed that in the previous, two steps back, I was supposed to do these capacitors too, which are the sort of stabilizing capacitors for the crystal. So I'll throw them on there now too. I've still got room. It's not a big hairy deal. Even following the instructions, I'm making mistakes. Just grab these capacitors quickly. And the LEDs. That's a little bit blob-tastic. Come on, I gotta come in from behind here. You guys are standing in my way. Did you know that? This soldering through a camera is not easy. I may have mentioned that in the past. Apparently that's a sin, cutting off the solder blob. Nobody will ever know. All I have left is headers now. The programming header goes this away. Oh, am I going to have to blue tack this? Okay, if I must. Holding it kind of straight. One thing I'm noticing, I'm starting to run out of places to hold this board by. But that's a problem that you have with pretty much any board holding soldering method, really. The more components you get on there, the less spots you have to hold it. Get that tack off there. Am I down solid? Yes, I am. Beauty. Now, I accept that this solder is a little bit big for this application, but it's better than that big Radio Shack stuff. This is still good. It's ancient. It's running a little bit low on flux. Some of it's leaked out and evaporated over the years. But until I find some skinny solder that's both relatively affordable and works properly, I'm just going to go with this. So, oh, nice. The pin headers that he sent me are more than necessary. That's cool. So, I'll just... That's the last one that I want to keep. Snap that one off. Yes, nice. Do the same on the other side. You know, normally when you're soldering header pins on, you drop it into a breadboard just to keep them straight. I think I may actually do that. Where's a little breadboard here? This is one thing I'm liking about soldering with these things, is it puts it a lot closer to my face, making it a lot easier to work with. When I'm down here on the workbench, that's a long way away. So there's those two pins in. That's kind of bobby. Yeah, so I, with it way down there, I can't really see what I'm doing all that well. Without, you know, getting my head down there between the camera and my work, which isn't an ideal solution if you're interested in doing video. Okay, there's two pins on that side and two pins on that side. So now I should be able to pop it up. Oh, instead of pulling the middle out. Okay, fine. I'm just going to solder all those off camera. You've seen me doing lots of soldering already. Okay, there's the last solder joint done on there. That's pretty slick. I think I'll just leave it on the breadboard actually for now. So, what's next? I think I'm going to throw some power onto it. So where's my 5 volts? Is there. And ground. So this is coming off my usual little power supply. I've got it set for 5 volts. And ground, there's one. There's several grounds, of course, but there's one of them. No chip in it right now. I just want to make sure there's no shorts. So, let me get that out of the way. So I'm going to turn on the power supply and go to current. So right now we have 2 milliamps and that's just got the power LED on. That's good. That tells me that I didn't short anything to anything between power and ground. Okay. So now then we have our chips. Let's grab one and make this happen. Oh, that foam has done its job. Those are nice and straight. That's good. Dot showing pin one, notch showing the pin one end. That's standard on through-hole dip ICs. And again, notch on the end of the chip socket, showing where that is. Put one side of the rows of pins in. And then just press back against it to get the other set in. Now they're all just kind of hovering there. And I noticed that I've done a bad thing. See that? So I will pop this guy out. Use my pliers to straighten that pin. And I think I will just sort of flatten them a little bit that way and we'll try again. They were almost all in. Eek. Just try and get it to go down nice and flat. There we go. That looks good. That was only minorly traumatic. So, if I've done this right, the listing or the instructions said it comes pre-programmed with a bootloader and with a variant on a blink sketch. So, I'll bring the power supply in, set it to current. I've got 300 current, milliamp current limit. Turn it on. 10 milliamps, that's good. What's going on? Oh, hey, look at that. It's blinking. We have achieved UNO. Nice. So now then, where's the programmer? So on here, we have ground at this side and 5 volts at that side. On here, we have ground at that side and 5 volts at that side. And for some reason, one labeled 3.3 volts there. Strange. I'm going to set this to use a 5 volt, right? I will put that on there in the orientation it wants to be. So what I'm going to load onto here is the basic blink sketch, but I've doubled it up. So it flashes twice. I call this one double blink. It flashes twice and then does a 1 second wait. That's all there is to it. So in order to program this thing, change it to Arduino UNO. I'll plug in the USB and tools, and it is USB TTY0. So this is on Linux. If you're doing this on Windows, the serial ports are going to look a little bit different. And also, some versions of Windows are stupid about the CH340 chip. You may have to go and find a driver. Linux just worked. Okay, let's go. Upload. And there we see the double blink happening. Excellent. So one thing that I did have to do, I had to push the reset button at the same time as I clicked the upload to get this thing to just quickly take a look and see if there's any incoming serial data while it was waking up. So that's the only real gotcha to programming this thing. But that's great. So now I can pull this programming board off, turn on my power, and there it is. Slick. So this guy in operation is almost the same size as a nano, but it uses a standard chip. So why would I want this? I don't know, partly for the novelty and building just an absolute minimalist UNO, because functionally, including sketches and bootloader and everything, that is this. But it's in this form factor. Yeah, I could just use this. It's the same chip too. It's just got a different bootloader on it. That's not a big hairy deal. But, I don't know. It seemed like a fun thing to do. And I'm supporting a local dude trying to run his business, which is nice. I guess I should mention that he doesn't even know who I am. I'm just a customer. I just found these, thought they were cool, and bought them. This isn't sponsored or anything. He didn't give these to me. I paid full price, blah, 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 blah. I could also just use the parts of one of those and put the whole thing together on a breadboard or in another circuit. I'm giddy with excitement. This was fun. So wrap up time here. This thing worked really well. The only place that it wasn't super handy was putting the whole rows of pins on. Everything else, it held it nicely. Once I started getting to the edges of the board, I started running out of places to grip, but that was okay. It holding the work up closer to my aging eyes really worked well. I like that. That was good. This solder worked well. I didn't expect it not to. It's 6040 Kester solder. What could go wrong? The only downside is I would like it to be a little bit skinnier, and I'm going to keep my eyes open for some better solder that's skinny for working with these tiny pins. And if I start working with surface mount, like, could you imagine using that big solder on these little guys here? Anyway, these kits I like them. And I got a couple more sitting there for that I can throw together at some point in the future. I had fun. This has been a good day. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching. Comments, questions, as usual, down below. I will talk to you later.